Avocados have become one of the world's most popular foods in the past two decades. Americans these days eat 9 pounds of avocados annually, and that's a huge leap compared to 2001, when the average American only ate 1 pound of avocados a year. As domestic consumption and global interest have soared, so have production and prices. From 2011 to 2022, the average nationwide retail price of a single avocado went up 60% from $1.11 to $1.76. But one avocado is not the same as the other. There are those small, pebble, cheap, greenskin avocados, and then there are those large, fatty, dark-skinned Haas avocados. For those on the West Coast or East Coast, the average retail price for a single Haas avocado is now as high as $2.99. Yet as prices have reached all-time highs, demand has not stopped. Whether it's avocado toast or guacamole in a Chipotle bowl, consumers continue to pay the premium for this fruit in the name of taste and nutrition. These 20 years of appreciation have turned avocados into a multi-billion dollar industry where farmers have nicknamed the fruit green gold. Forecasted for 5% growth every year for the next 5 years, even in a recession, the avocado industry is so lucrative that it's become a target for organized crime, leading people to label avocados as modern-day blood diamonds. In this episode, we'll cover the business of avocados, the major players, and how this simple fruit is at the heart of the political and economic relationship between the United States and Mexico. Average retail price alone doesn't capture the full story of avocados' growth. When we look at avocado production in the past 20 years, worldwide volume grew at 200%, from 2 million metric tons in 2000 to 9 million metric tons in 2020. Over the same time frame, the price per pound grew at 150%, meaning avocado prices have appreciated 6% every year. To put into perspective just how extraordinary this appreciation is for a commodity, if we compare avocados to assets like gold, real estate, and stocks, they actually come pretty close. In fact, the only asset that has truly outperformed avocados when it comes to appreciation is art. The appreciation of fine art is double that of avocados, sitting at 13.8% annually since 1995. Unlike avocados, art can help you keep your wealth intact in this period of high inflation, and that's where Masterworks, our sponsor, comes in. Just like how REITs have made it possible for anyone to invest in real estate without being a millionaire, Masterworks is democratizing the art market by allowing anyone to buy and sell shares in high-value art. With Masterworks, you can invest in art from renowned artists like Picasso, Monet, Warhol, and Banksy. So far, they've sold 5 paintings with an average net return of 26.8% to investors. And unlike some tech companies we've covered in past episodes, Masterworks is transparent, authentic, and compliant. Each artwork owned by Masterworks is officially securitized with the SEC as a legal public offering. With more and more people looking for hedges against inflation these days, Masterworks has a waitlist. But with this link, you can skip to the front of the line and start investing in art today. When you sign up, you can have a free one-on-one chat with a licensed advisor on how Masterworks works and how fine art can play an important role in your portfolio. Thank you to Masterworks for supporting Modern MBA and making this episode possible. While the media loves to push the story that it was millennials and their love for $10 avocado toast that popularized avocado consumption, the reality is that it all started, like many things in America, from decades of lobbying and evangelism. In the 1960s, avocado had a stigma of being unhealthy and fatty, and its Mexican origins didn't translate well with the ethnocentric views of American society at the time. In response, California farmers formed the California Avocado Commission. This organization's mission was to reset the narrative by marketing avocados as exotic Mediterranean fruits to American housewives. In the 1970s, a cover story on avocados in Sunset Magazine elevated guacamole from a Mexican-American staple into a mainstream favorite for all Americans. Then in the 80s, Latin American immigration to the United States increased, as well as avocado demand. In that same time frame, avocado consumption tripled in Mexico. As a representative of American farmers, the California Avocado Commission aggressively lobbied to keep Mexico from importing avocados into the U.S. through the 80s and 90s. Mexico back then and to this day remains the world's largest producer of avocados. Even when NAFTA came into effect in 1994, the California Avocado Commission successfully lobbied against imports for many years, arguing that Mexican avocados would spread disease. In 1997, this ban was lifted and avocados flowed plentifully from the south of the border. The marketing and evangelism of avocados as delicious, nutrient-dense superfruit continued into the 21st century. In 2013, the importers, exporters, and distributors combined forces to form Avocados from Mexico, Led by their iconic music jingle, this organization's charter is to drive further demand and promote the superior quality of Mexican avocados over those grown in other countries. Paying out millions of dollars year after year on Super Bowl commercials, social media sponsorships, nutrition studies, and gimmicky avocado restaurants show just how far the industry is willing to go to keep up demand and how much opportunity it believes still remains, even when current production and supply is unable to match demand. Demographics have played a role in the rise of avocado consumption as well, like the growing Hispanic population and the greater buying power of millennials. Hispanics consume avocado at a higher frequency than any other demographic, and today account for 19% of the U.S. population. The Hispanic population in the U.S. is forecasted to grow to 40% by 2050. As trend followers, the fast food and restaurant industry have incorporated avocado into their menus to win over millennials and health-conscious consumers. It's easier, cheaper, and more profitable to add avocado, whether raw or processed, to an existing food item than it is to make brand new dishes. But the popularity of avocado today is fundamentally the result of 6 decades of continuous marketing, evangelism, and lobbying from the industry. While there are over 500 types of avocados, there is only one variety that serves as the golden standard, that's the most commonly available, widely distributed, and popularly eaten. That's the Haas avocado. 95% of avocados in the United States and 80% of the avocados eaten worldwide are Haas avocados. There's many reasons for this. Haas avocados feature thick, firm, tough skins, which enable better durability during transportations. As Haas avocados ripen, their skin becomes dark, purplish-black, which hides bruises and blemishes. That's a huge win for retailers and grocery stores who know that when it comes to produce, consumers pick for appearance above all else. On the inside, Haas avocados boast a rich flavor that's high in oil and fat. Beyond the taste, durability, and aesthetics, Haas avocado trees have extraordinarily high yields compared to other varieties. A single Haas tree can produce 150 avocados a year with a lifespan of several decades. Farmers love Haas trees for their vigorous growth and fast turnaround in being able to produce avocados just 2 to 3 years after initial planting. Haas avocados can also hang on their trees at maturity for an exceptionally long period of time without withering, which allows farmers to harvest flexibly and continuously over time. This is a contrast to most crops that have very specific, fixed, seasonal time windows in which farmers must harvest before maturity in order to preserve quality. Before we dive into the companies, we have to first understand the supply chain, starting with how and where avocados are grown. The business of avocados is much deeper than just who can grow the most at the largest size for the cheapest price. Avocados are extremely delicate plants that only flourish in very select geographic regions that have the right combination of mineral-rich soil, abundant sunshine, moderate humidity, and mild climate. To put into perspective just how strict the conditions are for growing avocados at scale, there are only 2 areas in the United States where commercial avocado production is possible. Even with all its beaches, weather, and sun, less than 1% of California is suitable for growing avocados. All of California's 3,000 avocado farmers are concentrated in the Avocado Belt, a 300-mile strip in Southern California from San Diego to Morro Bay, where they grow Haas avocados. While Florida has more suitable land, farmers there are only able to grow greenskin avocados. Greenskin avocados from Florida have struggled to sell for decades as they have significantly less flavor and shorter shelf life than Haas avocados. With such strict growing conditions and so few suitable areas, it's no surprise that 8 out of every 10 avocados in the U.S. today arrive from Mexico. While NAFTA has made importation easier, the reality is that avocados are native to Mexico, which enables avocado production at a scale that no other country can match. With an annual production of 2.3 million metric tons, Mexico is the world's largest producer of avocados and the supplier for 45% of the international avocado market. 80% of avocados in the U.S. come from Michoacán, a western state within Mexico. Michoacán's volcanic soil, climate, sunlight, rainfall, topography, and natural irrigation make it the only place in the world where avocados can be grown and harvested nonstop 365 days a year. When we rank the top 10 countries with the highest avocado production in the world, the race isn't even close. Colombia is the closest and fastest growing competitor to Mexico with an annual production of 870,000 metric tons, but that's still 1/3 of Mexico's annual production. What's fascinating is how avocados run contrary to the natural commoditization that one expects crops to go through. Commoditization is that when demand increases, prices go up, and more producers enter the market. Then supply exceeds demand, prices drop before stabilizing, and the market reaches equilibrium where supply finally matches demand. In the case of avocados, the global demand has grown and continues to grow at such an aggressive pace that it doesn't follow commoditization. Production isn't the zero-sum game that theoretical economics makes it out to be. Since not even Mexico, as the world's largest producer, can produce enough avocados to meet demand, other countries and farmers in Colombia, Peru, and Southern California are still needed to provide supply. Commoditization also assumes that new producers produce goods at the same quality as existing producers. But avocados are so delicate as a plant that even if the environment is suitable, the natural differences in climate, soil, humidity, and sunshine from country to country have a noticeable impact in the end quality. As an example, Haas avocados from Peru have a poor reputation for being inferior in taste, texture, and size compared to Haas avocados grown in Mexico and California. In a market where consumers are exceptionally choosy, quality differences based on origin are noticeable. With these natural constraints in supply and variances in quality, commoditization of avocados is still decades away. This is why demand remains higher than supply and prices for avocados continue to soar. But a rising tide floats all boats, and in this case, all avocado farmers, regardless of their country and scale. Now that we've covered growing avocados, the next step is harvesting. To this day, avocados are gently harvested by hand with ladders and poles. A seasoned picker can pick 3,600 avocados in a single day. Avocados are delicate to the point that the temperature and humidity at the time of harvesting can have a huge impact on its shelf life and quality. One rule of thumb amongst farmers is that for every 10 degrees higher the temperature is at the time of picking, the shelf life is halved due to higher water loss and respiration. Harvesting is done during the cooler periods of the day or even at night. As soon as an avocado is harvested off the tree, it begins to ripen. So to prevent avocados from ripening too quickly, the avocados must be kept cool and then transported as soon as possible to the next stage in the supply chain, packing. A packing house is a facility where harvested avocado is received in bulk and then sorted. Avocados naturally begin ripening since their harvest, and being in any warm temperature only speeds up that process. The ripening of avocados must be strictly controlled so that the fruit reaches its final destination at the requested level of ripeness. If the avocados have already ripened by the time they arrive at their grocery store or supermarket, they'll turn mushy and rotten before they can be sold and used. Any heat gathered in avocados during harvest or transportation must be immediately removed. Some packing facilities bathe the avocados in pools of cool water to lower their temperature and wash off dirt. Other facilities choose to cool the avocados in refrigerated rooms. Ultimately, the faster the heat is removed, the better the shelf life and slower the deterioration is. If the avocados are arriving from Mexico, they must be held in a designated area with insect-proof screens. The avocados have to be deemed pest-free through biometric samples before they can be distributed into the United States. So if the facility is receiving avocados from various countries of origin, fields, and temperatures, packing can quickly become very complicated. Workers at packing facilities must be careful when handling avocados to avoid bruises, brown spots, or any damage that would harm the fruit's appearance. After cooling, the avocados are then sorted into three grades. The first grade is US number 1, which is the most visibly appealing avocados. They're clean, well-colored, well-formed, not overripe, and free of bruises, cuts, discolorations, spots, or disease. Avocados of this grade are the ones that are typically shipped to grocery stores to be displayed on shelves and sold to consumers. The second grade is number 2. These are avocados that are still good to eat, but suffer from visual damage. While they don't have any disease or serious damage, these avocados generally have a few cuts, bruises, inconsistent sizes, and less vibrant colors. These avocados are usually shipped to restaurants where aesthetics are significantly less important or directly processed into guacamole. The last possible grade is US number 3, which is for avocados that are significantly damaged or overripe. These avocados are unsellable and typically repurposed into animal feed. For the number 1 grade avocados that are destined for the grocery store, they're sorted by size, boxed up into cartons, and then shipped in refrigerated trucks to their final destination. Since maintaining cold temperature and preventing ripening is critical, trucks must position themselves in the loading docks tightly to minimize any cold air loss when the avocados are loaded into pallets and into the open container. All this happens less than a day after harvesting. Once these avocados arrive at the supermarket, they usually have a time window of 4 to 7 days to be sold before they spoil. If the store displays the avocados next to other fruits like bananas and mangoes, the avocado will ripen faster and have an even shorter time window to sell. For number 2 grade avocados destined to be made into guacamole, they're artificially flash ripened in pressurized rooms. That way, by the time these avocados reach the processing plant, they're ripe and ready to be smashed. These are the 5 core steps of the avocado supply chain: growing, harvesting, packing, processing, and distribution. In the avocado industry, there are 3 leading companies today that supply most of the world's avocados: Del Monte, Calavo Growers, and Mission Produce. For Del Monte and Calavo Growers, avocado are just one of many fruits offered in their portfolios. For Mission Produce, beyond a recent venture into mangoes, avocado is their specialty and primary focus. Mission Produce's strategy is to own the entire supply chain end-to-end from farm to delivery, whereas Del Monte and Calavo specialize exclusively in packing, processing, and distribution. The diversity of these 3 companies provide a great real-world opportunity to test the classic debate of which strategy nets the most profits: breadth versus depth, and horizontal integration versus vertical integration. When we rank Del Monte, Calavo, and Mission Produce by their avocado sales, we can see that Mission Produce is ahead by a significant margin with annual net sales of nearly $900 million. Calavo settles for second place with around $600 million sales every year in avocado and guacamole, while Del Monte is in last place with net sales of $300 million. Del Monte is a leader in fruits and vegetables as the world's biggest supplier of bananas and pineapples. However, Del Monte's avocado business doesn't have the same dominance as its pineapple and banana divisions. While bananas and pineapples combined make up on average 55% of Del Monte's annual revenue, avocados have contributed on average just 7% to the company's top line for the past 5 years. Despite global demand, Del Monte's avocado business to this day only serves the United States. The company specializes in the packing, processing, and distribution stages of the supply chain. Del Monte sources most of their avocados from independent farmers in Mexico and packs them in their facility in Michoacán. The remaining avocado supply comes from Peruvian and U.S. farmers. The company owns no farms directly or even through joint ventures, which leaves them having to purchase avocados from independent growers at daily market rates. While Del Monte doesn't provide any additional details on its avocado business beyond its annual sales, what's interesting is how razor-thin the margins are in produce. Despite being the market leader in pineapple and bananas, along with having a sizable market share in fresh cut and canned fruits, Del Monte's margins are slim. While the company's top line has grown at a healthy, consistent pace from $3.6 billion in 2013 to $4.3 billion in 2021, its average operating margin sits at 3% and its net margin is 2% for the past 8 years. While Calavo's product portfolio consists of avocados, tomatoes, and papayas, the company's roots and origins are in the avocado business. As the pioneer of processed guacamole in the 1960s, their long-running heritage has won Calavo major accounts like Walmart and Kroger. Those 2 retailers combined contribute 35% of the company's annual revenue. But contrary to their full name, Calavo Growers are not actually growers. Similar to Del Monte, Calavo only packs, processes, and distributes avocados. Despite decades of credibility with California farmers, demand is so high that Calavo pays daily market prices on a per-pound basis for their avocados. For farmers in Mexico, competition is so fierce that Calavo has to buy out all the avocados in a specific grove at a time. Only after the purchase price is agreed upon are those avocados harvested and delivered. When Calavo is unable to source enough avocados from farmers, they supplement supply by buying avocados from competing Mexican packers. This procurement process demonstrates just how intense the demand is for Mexican and California avocados and how much the market favors farmers in those areas. In Colombia and Peru, however, the market favors packers and not farmers. The variance in quality and poor consumer perception of avocados grown outside of Mexico and California mean that farmers now have to first prove their crops are good before getting paid. Peruvian and Colombian farmers are paid on a consignment basis, meaning they are only compensated after their avocados sell. Their payment is set as a percentage of the avocado's final net selling price, and farmers there don't have the leverage to demand upfront pay or daily market prices like those in Mexico and California do. Calavo's revenue has grown on average 6% year over year, going from $700 million in annual net sales in 2013 to over $1 billion in 2021. Fresh avocados make up a little over 50%, and guacamole contributes almost 10% of Calavo's annual revenue. But like Del Monte, despite their impressive top-line trajectory, the margins remain very thin for Calavo. Their average operating margin for the past 8 years sits at 4%, while the average net profit margin is 2%. It's odd that despite the strong avocado appreciation of the past 2 decades, that these companies aren't seeing their margins improve over time. Could it really be that all that appreciation is being captured by the farmers and not the packers, processors, and distributors? Mission Produce validates this hypothesis. As the industry leader with the most avocado volume and sales, Mission Produce is also surprisingly the youngest company of three, having been founded in 1983. The company is currently the world's largest supplier of avocados, and they've been exclusively focused on the tropical fruit for the past 4 decades. Mission Produce boasts a greater international presence than its competitors, being the first to export avocados to China, South Korea, and Japan, while servicing European customers through the Netherlands. Fundamentally, when it comes to packing and distribution, Mission Produce offers the same services as Del Monte and Calavo. The differentiation between Mission Produce and its two rivals is in its supply. Buying avocados from independent farmers is the single largest expense in the avocado business. The market favors farmers so much that Del Monte, Calavo, and Mission Produce, all three of these billion-dollar companies to this day, are still forced to buy avocados at daily market rates. Farmers in Mexico and California know that they hold all the cards, and no one is willing to sign exclusive contracts, sell, provide volume discounts, or even settle selling avocados at weekly or monthly rates. If a buyer won't pay market price, the farmer will just find someone else who will. And if there's no buyers, the farmers will just wait and let the avocados hang on the trees until someone pays. After all, the avocados won't rot until they're picked. Mission Produce gets around this oligopoly through vertical integration. The company owns and operates avocado farms spanning over 12,000 acres in Peru, Guatemala, and Colombia. By having production of its own, Mission Produce is able to dynamically adjust market pricing, minimize volatility, reduce its dependence on farmers, and maintain margins. When the market prices for Mexican and California avocados spike, the company fulfills orders using avocados from its own supply. These farms are long-term capital-intensive investments that only reach maximum production 5 to 7 years after planting. But this vertical integration is worth it. Mission Produce reports that the per-unit cost of avocados produced at their farms is consistently lower than the per-unit cost of avocados purchased from independent farmers. When we look at Mission Produce's fundamentals, we can see the company's strength in its double-digit margins. Mission Produce's top line isn't at the same level as Del Monte and Calavo, sitting at a little below $900 million in annual net sales for the past 3 years. But Mission Produce is able to capture more of the pie with fewer offerings, while the competition offers a wider breadth of products but with diluted margins. Mission Produce features an industry-leading average gross margin of 13%, an operating margin of 7%, and a net profit margin of 6%, triple that of its rivals. These 2 decades of appreciation have made many avocado farmers rich, but some are now paying a bloody price for this wealth. In Mexico, the avocado industry is now a target of drug cartels, where farmers are extorted, shipments are stolen, and farms take center stage in turf wars. Cartels are constantly evolving, and being able to launder and skim money from a growing legal billion-dollar industry invites far less scrutiny than smuggling illegal drugs across the border. Yet these issues have not slowed demand. When a cartel issued death threats to USDA officials earlier this year for inspecting a shipment of avocados a little too closely, consumers were more concerned about a guacamole shortage for their Super Bowl parties than the alarming connections and ramifications of such an incident. The economic significance of avocados is so great that in less than 10 days, the Mexican and US government had patched things up, the USDA lifted its ban, the cartel involvement was swiftly buried in the media as a one-off freak accident that shouldn't weigh on anyone's conscience, and avocados resumed flowing freely across the border. So the next time you buy an avocado, check out the sticker to see what country it comes from and which company supplied it. What you're holding in your hand is more than just a simple tropical fruit to mash into guacamole, or slice into tacos, or spread onto toast. To some, it's green gold, to others, it's a modern-day blood diamond, but to everyone, it's a piece of a billion-dollar industry so big that it transcends politics.